Distinguished speakers, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and a very good afternoon. First of all, I want to record my humble thanks and great appreciation to our host and organizers for bringing us all the way from Malaysia to Iran to this, for me, very, very historical meeting. And I have the impression, I have the feeling that we need this kind of workshops and meetings in Malaysia as well. So inshallah, we will try to work towards such collaborations in the future. So we cannot repay you for your kind hospitality and generosity. Only God can do that. I just feel that you are like family. So I think you understand by that. And in the context of the topic today, which is academic imperialism and community, I would like to share with you some thoughts and experiences that we have at university, at home, in the context of the academic community and also the lay community, in the area which you might have heard of, sustainable development and or education for sustainable development. I know some of you may say that this comes from somewhere and therefore this is one kind of imperialistic instrument. But I beg your pardon if you do think that way. But in our experience, sustainable development, if you think about it, if you let yourself be immersed in it, for me, coming from a science background, coming from a family, a community that holds fast to its faith and religion, for us, sustainable development is a way of de-imperializing ourselves. So I hope to explain what I mean in this few slides that I want to share with you. So if you look at this slide, why is it that for me, sustainable development, thinking about sustainability is worth our while, especially in the discourse of meeting the challenges of academic imperialism, is because if you look at that picture, it is, by the way, done by a futurist, Richard Slaughter. And futurists, this morning we heard one statement, I think, I've forgotten who, but someone talked about the future this morning. And the future is the only thing that we have. The past is gone. And now will soon be gone as well. So live in the now for the sake of the future. So if you look at this, what has happened is that thus far, we have forgotten the left-hand side. The left-hand side. We have put our efforts and energy to concentrate on the physical dimension of life. So if you look at the total environment that Dr. Munir was telling us about, we have to bear in mind that these two realms needs to be balanced. But the way things have gone, and we don't have time to go into the history and philosophy of science of the world, but if we understand what has happened in the last, let's say, 200 to 300 years, for example, we will understand that in the realm of the physical section of our life, it is very easy to see that what we have, buildings, the physical things that we have, they have underlying foundations, which if they are strong, the physical structure will be strong. But we don't think as much in the other social dimension. And a lot of statements were made this morning also how the human and social sciences actually fare worse if you compare to the physical sciences in terms of imperialism. So I think I tend to agree with that, but I mean that I say that in a very humble way. And that's because I think we don't, people in the science, in the social sciences, in the arts, even in the religious studies, do not make use of analogies from the physical side. If you look at this picture, it makes such great sense to me. Why can't we, for the sake of practicality, for the sake of understanding quickly and immediately what is going on, use analogies from the sciences? And I would appeal to my friends and colleagues who are in the religious sciences to make use of science and religion, which is my area, by the way, because I was besotted by this issue of being a scientist, what do I make of my religion? Is it irrational, as science said to me that it was? Or is there some other way of looking at it? So this was my entry point into de-imperializing myself. And I think departments such as History and Philosophy of Science can help, together with other departments, of course. But what I'm talking about here is, if you look at the squashed arrow in between those two boxes, there's a bridge that needs to be created. So bridges are very critical, bridges are very important, and we need to make, to build many of those. And I would imagine that coming from the center called Civilizational Dialogue Center, dialogue is the key word, and like somebody also said this morning, dialogue is not simply talking to each other. Dialogue is such that the partners will come out of the discourse having the picture even more crystallized. So talking about imperialism is not pointing fingers, it's not about where is West and what is West and where are we and who are we, you know, like Professor Munir says. But I think dialogue is about taking responsibility. And I think the people who feel that they are imperialized, yes, you can be angry, you can be upset, you can look at all the negative impacts of colonization, etc., etc. But I say to you, like you've also heard this morning, you cannot change things overnight. We are at where we are at the moment. And that is why, for me, if you look at sustainable development, it is important. The idea gives you space for indigenous wisdom to come into the picture. For us to look back at our traditions, what can our religion, can our local systems contribute to current need for solutions? There is an area now called sustainability science. This has been started by a group of engineers and scientists. There was quite a bit of engineer bashing, I think, today, and I mean that also in a light way. Those who are engineers and physicists, please don't feel bad. But again, this is the kind of I think soft skill or style which we have to be careful of. That is the adab, I think, of quarrelling, the adab of saying what is right and what is wrong. And adab is something that this picture is telling us. So on the left-hand side, if we want a very strong social architecture or social makeup of society, then we have to make strong, we have to strengthen all the things that are the ingredients of social structure, which is the language element, the symbols, the customs, the laws, the constitutions, the institutions, the family institution. One thing we marvel at in Iran is the strength of the family. We marvel at the strength of the family. How you treat us is just like family, as I said just now. And that's really rare on the planet of the Earth. And I think that's something that Iran can afford to imperialize other people with, if we want to use that word. Because another thing is, we have to demystify words. Do not be put off by words. The question of meaning is utterly important. You can be using any word that you like, but explain what you mean by it and what you want to do with it. So it doesn't matter what words you use, because to begin with, imperialization for me is a strong word, because it has certain historical connotations. But again, you know, just like this is the mouse, why is this a mouse? Why can't you call it the rabbit? So it's the meaning that you put into things, and question of meaning is really important here. And how does society find its meaning? By looking back at its cultural norms, cultural assumptions, ethical and moral framework. Today, people are saying that we are technological giants, but moral midgets. Why is that so? Who are the people that are supposed to strengthen us once again vis-a-vis morality? So this is where we cannot run away from worldview. In the West, in places where also the West, which can happen in the East. I mean, the West also exists in the East, West, quote-unquote. But what we mean here is that we must be able to use language that unite people in terms of their perceptions, in terms of their common goals. So this is where, in the context of Iran, Malaysia, for example, or countries that say that they are overwhelmingly religious, this is where religions can play a role. This is where religious studies and religious teaching and learning can play a role by taking on concepts and ideas from other fields of knowledge. So if we don't do this, we will have the situation where at the universities, for example, and what is a university? It is a community. How can you say that a university is not part of the community? I mean, again, I am one of those people who have deprofessoralized myself, I think, because I am an academic, but at the same time, I cannot divorce what I do at the university from real life out there. So the role of academics today in Malaysia, for example, are being looked at on both sides. On the one hand, we have to go for our RSI publications and world ranking and whatnot. But there is also a strong movement to self-criticize, to review what's going on. So one idea is that if we are not careful with what we're doing with our students, universities can become undifferentiated from a business corporation. This has also been mentioned this morning, engaged in the delivery and exploitation of research and educational products, including students. We'll have this situation which is described by this picture, the assembly line education. But again, what do I do with this scenario? Do I despair? I don't. Because as we said earlier, the here and the now, you have to grapple with it. And for those of us who are so-called Muslims or who are so-called people of faith, we believe in tests. Those who have iman will be tested. Our tradition tells us that. So we don't have to bang our heads on the wall. We don't have to feverishly look around who to blame. For me, there's an opportunity here. The language, look at the language, the market, the customer, the students are our products. And like someone said this morning, if the products become useless, then we just throw them away. But no, for me, this is an opportunity for us to bring in our indigenous values. If we can strengthen, can renew, bring back our understanding and implementation and manifestation of that faith. And because, you know, I'm so sorry to say this, I hope I will not hurt anybody's feelings, religion is not being taught in a dynamic way. It is still taqlid that is the method, that is blind following. And I think you should, as far as possible, teach religion with understanding. And if you look at the section of where it says value add, this is where teachers, lecturers, professors, or whoever who are in the university can make the link between academe and community. That's where you can de-imperialize. You know, the beautiful thing for me being an academic is that you can do that research. I don't mean to stop research at when you finish the research project, that's it. You know, I'm for me, research is a continuous situation. But my point here is, when the world is looking for answers for unsustainability, which has been beautifully described by Professor Munir when he refers to nature being ruined and all of that. We know the problems of climate change, etc., etc. This is the area where nobody is dictating to us that we cannot bring in local values. So at University of Malaya, for example, and many other universities, I'm sure, we are looking, let's say, just very simply at local Malay proverbs that teaches us values, that actually, and Malay proverbs, I'm sure, the same with Iranian proverbs, they refer to nature. Like we have one that talks about one plant, aur, that lives near the river banks. So we say, ba'aur dan tebing. This is talking about unity as a result of that plant living by the river bank, cooperating with the bank of the river. So it strengthens the land. It doesn't, it stops breakages, it stops, the land being destroyed and going into the river and being washed away. So we have many such proverbs. And nobody is looking at proverbs anymore. Proverbs used to be taught at schools, in primary and secondary schools, and nobody is looking at it. But I'm saying there's so many things in our culture, in our traditions, that nobody is actually directly saying, don't do it. We talked this morning about how students can no longer decide, you know, this and that. They can't. You can't ask them questions because they don't like it. They don't like to think this is what we assume. But I don't think so. So we want to stop basic education, for example. The most important thing, the most critical thing in life, and of course we can debate about what we mean by education, being the least important in people's concept, people with power. And look at where most of the money is being spent on. Okay? And in between, you can have a look. So with that, I thank you for listening, and I hope to be able to interact with you again. Thank you so much.